Mention Baltimore, and this is what most people think of. Riots. Fires. Looting. Businesses destroyed. Hundreds arrested. The flames and furor followed the death of a young black man in police custody. But here's a very different view of Baltimore. Volunteers of many backgrounds working together for the common good. Fewer people are aware of Baltimore's reputation for helpfulness and charity, something that's developed over almost 200 years. Here at the Real Food Farm, in a giant plastic-covered greenhouse, volunteers are transplanting and pruning strawberries, learning to farm and growing food for city people who never get enough fruits and vegetables to eat.
There's always a need for volunteers. We have need in especially spring and fall, help prepping beds and getting plants out in the summertime. We even need help with the harvest. And in the winter, we need help breaking everything that we are fixing everything that we broke all year.
Many volunteers are students.
I'm mostly here just because I love farming. It's a great escape from just like my lifestyle as a high school student, but also it's just really fun to know that the work you're doing is going straight to helping people.
It's definitely fulfilling, and it makes you realize how fortunate you are living the where you live and how you live in comparison to other people who don't have what you have.
This day's volunteers include a mother and daughter.
Pretty much we grow a lot of the things that they grow here, so I learn a lot by coming I just apply at home.
Well, I've had a couple friends volunteer with me before. They live close by to here, so because my school's around here. So I just kind of pick them up on Saturday mornings, and then we're like, okay, let's go farm.
Some students stress practical values.
And that's a really good experience. It also provides a lot of hands-on experiences outside of school to do like great things like farm for the urban society.
And I believe in a way that it also helps us kind of prepare for college, because we are individuals and we are independent, doing something on our own.
The home base for projects like the farm, helping the elderly, finding jobs for the unemployed, and transforming scrubby vacant lots into community gardens is Clifton Mansion, headquarters of Civic Works, a private nonprofit corporation that's been working with the city for 20 years. Appropriately enough, Baltimore's tradition of doing good is centered in this former home of the city's best-known philanthropist, Johns Hopkins, a 19th-century Maryland farm boy who became the biggest stockholder in the Baltimore and Ohio Railroad. The railroad made the city a vital national transportation link and made Johns Hopkins rich and famous. When he died in 1873, he left more than $7 million to charity.
At the time he gave the money, the $7 million was the largest single philanthropic gift in American history to that date.
Hopkins' $7 million, equal to $140 million today, went partly to establish Johns Hopkins University, now one of the world's greatest academic institutions, and partly to build this country's most highly rated hospital. Johns Hopkins Hospital and Medical School have led the way in modern American medicine. George Peabody, a visionary 19th century banker, established Baltimore's philanthropic tradition of community uplift. His gift of $1.5 million created the Peabody Institute, which includes a famous music school, art gallery, library, and concert hall. Enoch Pratt, a hardware multimillionaire, brought the city its revolutionary free library, where poor blacks as well as rich whites could borrow books for nothing. It remains the city's main library system. Baltimore's other leading 19th century philanthropists include a father and son, William and Henry Walters. William bought European art. Henry bought even more and built the Walters Art Museum. Like the Walters Museum, Clifton Mansion, Johns Hopkins' old home, is now a city-owned landmark. It's sometimes the scene of reenactments of battles around Baltimore in the War of 1812. Inside is this etching of the British bombardment of Fort McHenry in Baltimore Harbor. Francis Scott Key watched the attack from a ship and famously described the rocket's red glare and bombs bursting in air in a poem that became the words of our national anthem. One of those bombs, an unexploded cannonball filled with shrapnel, is also on exhibit. Clifton Mansion is part of a 200-year-old historic and philanthropic tradition. Adante Hart is a part of that tradition, a Johns Hopkins graduate who now teaches cooking classes and volunteers at the farm.
Definitely want to tell, you know, my coworkers, you know, come out to a farm, spend some hours just, you know, putting your hands in the dirt and really just getting involved with the soil, because I think it's really something special about, you know, getting back to the soil and seeing where your food comes from, and it helps you appreciate foods more and more.
Civic Works needs more volunteers to keep alive that vital 200-year-old Baltimore tradition, a tradition of helping others, in a city sometimes called the nation's cradle of philanthropy.
A junk graveyard. Like Dante in Paradise Lost, she needed a poet to lead her out of the inferno. That poet is Lewis McAdams. 40 years ago, cutting a hole in a wire fence, he crept down and asked her if he could speak for her. She didn't say no. And that's how Friends of the Los Angeles River began.
The river is a rigorous mistress, but when you tickle her with your deeds, you can hear her laughter from beneath her concrete corset.
So, do you know who wrote that?
No.
Well, the river can always hear us.
Wake up, honey, and listen to the wind outside.
The river is a rigorous mistress.
But when you tickle her with your deeds, you can hear her laughter
from beneath her concrete corset. It's pretty deep.
What do you think a corset is?
A corset is like something that's form-fitting, that like gives a woman shape.
I think that refers directly to this river, which is paved with concrete. But it's whimsical, that's what a river is. You can never step in the same river twice.
The hurricane is breaking through tonight. Mother Nature's unchecked wrath won't leave nothing in her path. This morning she scorched.
The river is a regard mistress, but when we tickle her with your deeds, you can hear her laughter from beneath her concrete corset.
Yeah, I'll go. Oh shoot! Oh, that was a bad
one. I'm pretty sure he's saying that even if we cover up our land with the concrete, there's still life blooming underneath it. But it's hidden from the world, so we cannot see its beauty.
You can hear her laughter from beneath her concrete corset.
I guess
I guess it would mean when you'd like disturb her, the dark stuff or the stuff that you don't want comes from all over the place, I guess. I would say that.
To me it means you need to be careful.
Mother Nature's unchecked wrath won't leave nothing in her path. This morning she scorched up the plains, now she's brought the wind and rain.
I mean, for me, it's, you know, it's recognizing and taking a look at, you know, what you do and how it affects what's around you, in this case being the river, and just knowing that we can make a difference and be a part of it.
The hurricane is breaking through tonight. The hurricane is breaking through tonight.
Wait, who do you think wrote that?
It was either Walt Whitman, because I don't think concrete was around then, or who's the other one? Adams? There's a poet. Yeah, there's a poet from the 20th century. It's Adams something, but Walt Whitman is my guess.
Lost Valley's bow tie, Fletcher bow tie, and frog spot are estimated to have about 1,000 volunteers.
The river is the unknown gem of Los Angeles, so we need to clean it up and keep taking care of it and bring it back to life.
Why am I here? Because we love LA, and we love our river, and we want it to be as nice as possible.
Like fishing, isn't it?
Hey, look at it, it's getting right there. If we get to that log, you got another big piece. Oh no, it went by.
Barbed wire doesn't stop volunteers.
No, they did a perfect job. You know, not only the volunteers, but the staff, Cleaning Green, Conservation Corps, from everybody, you know, joined together to make the LA River better again. As you could tell, all this trash came from the river. And thanks to the volunteers and everybody, you know, we could keep the river maintained clean again.
It's an anime. It's basically about this guy who comes from outer space and he gets used to Earth and then he's a Super Saiyan and then he kills bad guys that try to kill Earth.
Yeah, he's technically a god. He's technically a god. He fights bad guys.
And is it, does he really volunteer?
Yeah. He does.
How does he volunteer?
He saves the Earth like 1,000 times.
Say that again.
He saves the Earth like 1,000 times. Yeah.
After today, what do you think about the river being the same river?
Well, it definitely isn't the same river because all these volunteers just helped out a lot to clean it up. And I mean, obviously there's still a lot more to get clean, but it's a good step forward. Yeah.
Last volunteers.
There's a couple more out back there still in
At Red Wiggler Community Farm, we grow and sell vegetables as a framework for training adults with intellectual and developmental disabilities. On our 7-acre farm, we grow about $125,000 worth of produce annually, and 40% of that produce is distributed to low-income households. And we bring in volunteers to work alongside our clients, who we call growers, towards the common goal of growing great, healthy, certified organic vegetables. People can actually volunteer as consultants to help us run our business a little better.
Come on out every Thursday to the Leech Road to the Red Wiggler Community Farmers Market, where you can buy tomatoes just like this.
Travel Television is honored to have Senator Harris Wofford, who has a long history in the civil rights and service movements. During the Kennedy era, Senator Wofford worked with Sergeant Shriver to create the Peace Corps, and 50 years later, he continues to be a leader for community and national service.
The war on poverty included what now we would call AmeriCorps, but the initial organization still exists, the service for older Americans on the young, secondly, a jump start and early start for large numbers of people were started. Domestic Peace Corps was that it would be at least as big as the Civilian Conservation Corps of Franklin Delano Roosevelt, which came to 500,000 all told in 1 year, but for millions for the years that it existed before World War II turned the service into military service.
There's several programs for baby boomers as well. So what are your thoughts on the thousands that join that group each year?
Well, I hope that, in a sense, all of this that I'm talking about is not just limited to young people. I've been part of a venture called the Experience Wave to try to persuade governors and legislators and civic groups and others to multiply the number of opportunities, making use of the talent that the baby boomers, now that they're booming maybe, but not babies anymore, can be offered as, those who are approaching retirement in a number of places go into The Peace Corps, for example, itself, it relishes getting older people with real skills, and I think that ought to be high on the agenda of the American people on how those opportunities, the hard working years in your career, are the less are the ones that are the periods that are least people are free to do what a student out of high school or out of college or halfway through college or in the first decade can do before they settle on which their career is. And maybe they find the career in part by volunteer service. But I was saying that a lot of the volunteer work, nonprofits, were very irritated with Shriver calling them Peace Corps volunteers because volunteering means free. And of course, General McChrystal in the military says that's not what the volunteer army, which we adopted, have. They have to get supported. And if you want full-time service, unless you leave it to those who are really wealthy, it has to be supported in one way or the other. And I relish the time in which it's predominantly supported by the civic center section, and not depend just on government.
Mm-hmm. All right, thank you so much, Senator Wofford. We really appreciate you being here. For Travel Television, I'm Kari Keenan.
Today we're visiting a local community that's part of the Oshawa tribe. There are about 20 families that live here, and we're gonna meet the shaman and show you what it's like to live in the Amazon today. And as you can see, we got a little buddy out here, a little dog, some chickens, some roosters, and then this is their home. And the shaman greets on one side people who come here, and on the other side is where the family does the work. And they like to keep it separate. The women stay on that side, and the shaman, the male, stays on this side. And so we're gonna go inside and take a visit. Inyahe. Thank you. I wanted to thank him for letting us into his home. And like I mentioned, this is the area where he greets people, the social part of his home. And over here, you'll see this is where the women do the work. And they gave us a welcoming drink when we originally came here, and we spent some time chatting, and we watched the ladies work. This is his wife, and this is his daughter, and they're here working. And this is where they sleep, and as you notice, they've got the netting because of the mosquitoes, but this is obviously a dual working place where they work and they live. One of the things I noticed when I came in were the clothes. Very much Western style, because in the 1970s, the missionaries came and they are now Catholic. And part of the missionaries coming here, the background were the tribes that were around here, even within the community, sometimes there was a lot of fighting. And with the introduction of Catholicism, the fighting dissipated, and now some of the Western culture is coming to bear. When I spend time with people from different cultures, I always uncover something interesting. This shaman talked to me about his training. Did you know that part of his training is going 6 months without sex? How about this? He had to do hallucinogenics in order to enter an altered state so he could tap the resources that would help him heal people when he came back to his community. Well, with that said, my crew thought it'd be a great idea if I entered an altered state. Well, I quickly thought about it, processed it, pictured myself running naked through the rainforest with two guys filming it while I was on drugs, and decided probably not the best career move, Murph. So instead, I sat down, learned more about the community, and how as recently as 2011 is the first time anything's changed when they introduced electricity to this small community.
Irmo Dog Retreat owner Kay Massey houses rescue dogs at her boarding and grooming kennel. Fido Dog Rescue and the Heartworm Project both have dogs at the kennel with stories that'll melt your heart.
I think they might someday adopt you. They might.
They stay there until they get fostered or adopted.
When they're here, they're here. That's Wes's room. It doesn't matter how busy I am, that's Wes's room. You know, he's not getting booted anywhere.
It's not easy matching dogs up with the right foster, and they're not the only animal to have problems finding forever homes.
Dale Gause, a partner with Sunset Felines, is currently housing 35 cats at his West Columbia home, just like Dimitri here, because they do not have enough foster families to help take care of these kitties. And students can really find a way to help out with these nonprofits and discover what it's like to have a pet.
Frankie Johnson is the founder of Sunset Felines, a West Columbia organization dedicated to the trap, spay, and release of cats in the area. They've had 4 different fosters and feeders drop out in the past few months.
We have a tremendous need for administrative type things, people to type letters, send out emails, contact businesses about donations, recruit volunteers.
Many students at the University of South Carolina have pets, especially if they live off campus. Fourth-year student A.J. Needler just moved into the Woodlands with his sugar glider, Gary. To his surprise, he's actually living in a 2-pet home.
I think that pets are a great thing, that they help with stress relief. They help you with that love and that care that you want.
He thinks pets are beneficial for student living, but understands they're not for everyone.
We as college students may not necessarily be ready for the commitment. We don't know what it's going to take.
Becoming a foster parent to a pet in need could help students decide if they're ready to dedicate themselves to caring for an animal.
Well, they look to you as their family. I'm definitely Gary's family.
Not only are students an untapped resource to make a difference for animals in need, but the animals could make a huge difference in student life too. Jenny Eiler, Carolina News.